How different will be your pasta, Ashish?
You've heard some very expensive procedures. So post-lunch, I'm going to give you the frugal needle technique. And frugal is not a synonym for cheap. So we'll talk about cuff preservation.
So give me a word before you start. Schizophrenia for subscap, what's the word for pasta?
I told you, it's a frugal needle technique. So you've got a new
frugal needle. Yeah,
frugal needle
I
by
knew
the frugal
that.
Chef. Not our patient, not all patients are going to be affording all implants. So see, technically, if you have a pasta and sometimes if the tendon is degenerate and poor quality, you can always cut it down and do the repair. And I would do that sometimes. If the tissue is diseased, you just have to take it down. But then this talk is over in one statement, and you just do it like your conventional cuff repair technique. So sometimes I do that, but here I thought I would take the opportunity and show you a frugal needle technique. To understand which pastas to repair, you must understand anatomy, and from Ruotolo's and other studies, we know that the medial lateral footprint insertion of the cuff from medial to lateral is 12 mm. Anything that's 3 and 4 mm doesn't excite me. I would not operate it, and neither should you. Anything that's 50% and more peeled off, not a formal tear, peeled off. So that's 50%, I would treat it if it is symptomatic, if it is symptomatic. And then I think the Ellman-Snyder classification is very nice. So the type A's and type B's, we can ignore, treat, inject, whatever it works in your hands. Is the 7 to 10 mm, which are incomplete tears that ought to be treated. So this is a case, Amit, note that he's not 54 years old, and RTA, painful for 9 months, and restricted range of movement. These are difficult to examine, and their cuff is not strong, but it's neither zero, it's not three, grade three. So they are some strength, and the testing is always equivocal because there's a lot of pain inhibition. These patients are more painful and more stiff than your full thickness cuff tears. And the MRIs are deceptive because there's a lot of signal there, so you need to measure it yourself. So once you put in an arthroscope and you measure that, yes, this is 6 mm and more, I would go ahead and do it. No dogma here. You could do it as a complete takedown tear and do it as a formal cuff repair, or you could do it in the box like I'm going to show you. And I think the tendon quality decides. If a tendon looks healthy, younger patient, most of them are slap related, I would actually preserve the native cuff and try and preserve it. Either techniques that you do, whether you take it down or you do it in situ, there is always a strong risk of over-tightening, which means post-op they'll be very painful. So you start, I think the uninitiated should look at the animation because it's much simpler to understand, because the cuff not taken down, it's very crowded inside, difficult to appreciate, so I have an animation for you. So first thing you do is, irrespective of what you do, you have to prepare the footprint, and once you've done that, you use the defect, pass in a needle, just make a 4 mm defect, not a formal this thing. I previously used to use the cannula. Now I don't use the cannula, but if you use the cannula, it should be a 4 mm cannula. You don't want to do a bigger than that cannula. That's precisely to avoid taking the tissues inside. And once you do that, you insert your anchor in there and get your double loaded anchor so that you have your four sutures. And then everything else is done as a suture shuttle. But we don't want to take down the cuff, and we don't want to use the clever hooks because they dent and make a bigger hole in the tissue. So you use a very fine needle. That's why it's a frugal needle technique. And once we've inserted the anchor, we've got four sutures inside. We will go in and separate the two sutures so you don't get them mixed up. Pass in a needle, remove the stilet, and pass in the ethylon. So number one, ethylon works well. It goes through your typical needle that you use in your arthroscopy. So once you've passed your ethylon through, then you retrieve that suture. Once you've retrieved the suture, then you do a suture shuttle on that so that you can pull it out and then tie the suture, actual suture, onto that, and then do a suture shuttle. And then you do this sequentially one by one, and typically you form a series where you start from anterior to posterior, or posterior to anterior, it doesn't matter, but you have to have one system in there because the team should understand what you're doing. So this is your suture shuttle, and as your suture shuttle goes through, you will see that The suture should not tie. This is the outside picture. On the outside, what you're trying to do is, once you've got all your sutures organized, you pull them in through the cannula one by one, because you've gone subacromially. The subacromial preparation has been done before you've actually put in the anchor and the sutures. And then you start tying them outside. But whilst you're doing this tying, you're watching the scope to ensure that the cuff will progressively sit down. That's very important for you to understand. So that's the passage of the needle, and you're doing this. So it's a little tricky because you need to know your 3D anatomy so that once you pass a needle from outside, it's going in through exactly where you want it to in a sequence. And as long as it comes out in a clean subacromial space, it doesn't matter where the sutures are, because you will organize those sutures at the end. So this is, watch the animation there. So as you're passing the sutures down the bursa, you're pushing the cuff down sequentially, progressively, and that requires a very good knotting technique so that you are actually putting the cuff down to its footprint. That's what you have to achieve, because as the cartilage finishes, your cuff must start. You don't want to leave a pasta kind of, or a pasta kind of defect inside, because that beats the purpose of this whole surgery. And at the end of it, once you've finished, you put in your scope back in the glenohumeral joint and check that you've done an anatomical repair. So you must not have too much tension. It should sit on the footprint, cover the complete footprint, and ensure that the cartilage and cuff start off identically. Now, if you look at literature, there are many ways to it, and there's a lot of dyshomogeneity, but if you, whatever technique you do, you just must do it right, sir. It comes handy. Snyder actually published his result and said just debridement and subacromial decompression, but that's a bit dated. I would certainly not do that. So far said that because the largest pain fibers are in the bursa, you would actually take down the cuff and do a formal cuff repair like you normally do, which is fine. And otherwise, you've got Yang Su's article where he's done a transtendon repair and use the original defect as a secondary entry point for the anchor. In conclusion, it doesn't matter what you do. But whatever you do should be tangible, and you should have a good outcome measure, which should have a result-oriented technique, and then you stick to that technique. So I just gave you an additional technique to do this by preserving the original nature's tissue and do a repair. So whether you do a subacromial or do it in the box like I showed, both results are comparable. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish.